Hello and welcome to Education Scotland's The Pedagogy Podcast. I'm your host, Bex Ewart, and I will be leading us through some really interesting conversations around about pedagogy with a really wide and broad spectrum of educational professionals, children and young people. This podcast came about as a response to the OECD report, which found that in order to improve the quality of outcomes for our children, practitioners and teachers need to be supported to explore their own pedagogy and their practice through a pedagogical lens. Unsurprisingly, in the early years, it's been a focus, and so there's a lot of research and policy documents and research papers around about the subject of pedagogy. But as we move through the school stages and into secondary school and further education, that reference to pedagogy drops off. We'll be talking to a whole host of educational professionals from the early years through primary, young children and people from various different stages in their education, and then right into further education, exploring pedagogy, what it means to different people, and what we might change and what we might challenge ourselves around to ensure that our education meets the needs of our children and young people as we move into an exciting but unknown future. Okay, hi everybody. Welcome to this episode of Education Scotland's The Pedagogy Podcast. And I'm very excited today to be talking with Andreas Schleicher, who is the Director for Education and Skills at the OECD, which, as you'll know, is part of the driver for the start of this podcast. And over to you, Andreas. Could you give us a little bit of information about your story, your journey as to how you ended up where you are now?
Yeah, actually, I started my career in medical research. I worked in medical industry first, and then I had to do my civil service, and they sent me to a school with disadvantaged children, and that's really created for me the interest to change my career, my job, to work in a different field. I could really see how much of a difference school can make for the children who need our support most. Yeah, and then, you know, I started to work in the field of education and got involved in education research and through our comparative study and finally applied at the OECD, and that's how I got here. And I think I have the most privileged position in education today. You know, I've been in schools in over 80 countries and really seen a lot and learned a lot every day. I meet really great people in policy and practice, and I think the world is an amazing laboratory for educational experiences, isn't it?
So you have a science background rather than a pedagogical background.
Yeah.
Do you think, how does that link into how you view education as a system? Does that change your view on it, do you think?
Yeah, it's a good question. I believe that, you know, we shouldn't make education less an art. It has always an aspect of, you know, it's a very human enterprise, but we should certainly make it more of a science. If we want to make good practice replicable, then it's going to be very important that we have a deeper understanding of what makes good practice great, and how can we actually learn from it, extrapolate from it, apply it in new fields. And I miss that often in education. Now, often we treat education merely as an art, you know, as something, as a craft that, you know, you're either talented with or not, or less. So, and we ask too rarely the question of, you know, what makes for great teaching, great learning, and how can we actually, you know, make good practice more systemic now. And this is, you know, you have a very atomistic culture in education. Often teachers work in isolation in their classrooms. It's actually very limited, you know, lateral knowledge flows, sharing. And most of the structures in education are vertical. Now you talk to your school principal, the school principal talk to the regional administrator, and so on. But, you know, ask yourself how much time do teachers spend beyond instruction to work with each other, to frame good practice, to learn from and with each other about, you know, successes and failures. How much do schools know about each other? How much do schools engage in collaborative practice? And I think that's very different from the field I grew up with, science. You know, if you actually invent something in the field of science, tomorrow the whole world will know about it, and you become very famous. And if you do an amazing job as a teacher in the classroom, you're lucky if, you know, 30 parents will recognize you for that. Nah.
So I suppose in terms of what we're talking about there, the practice within that sits pedagogy and the complexities around that. So what does the term pedagogy mean to you?
Well, pedagogy is really the art of and the science to bring, you know, good ideas into reality, to translate concepts and into practice and to change behavior. In a way, I think it comes from a deep understanding of what how humans learn and how they learn best. And then to create an enabling environment for those capacities to develop. Now, that's really what good pedagogy is about.
So you talked there about how humans learn best. So from your global perspective, where you've obviously got many data sources, what are the key features that you've seen around about how do humans learn best, and how is that fostered and nurtured in education?
Well, you see, we see an enormous world of differences here. And if you look, even with similar amounts of learning times, the PISA results can vary hugely between countries, between individuals, between systems, between school types. And I think that really tells us that it is really about the environments that we create, to what extent are children, young people really engaged and interested in what they learn. The kind of things that you remember from your own school experiences are the moments when you did something, not when somebody talked to you, not when someone explained the results of a scientific experiment to you, but when you did that experiment and learned from it. And I think that's really important that we create and shape those kinds of situations and contexts.
Shaping that those kind of context doesn't seem to fit with the traditional idea of the teacher as the person who holds the knowledge and imparts the curriculum to the child. Is there a tension between that kind of historical, systematic way that education is set up and actually now what we know about the conditions for deep learning for individuals?
You know, there's another really interesting point that you make. You know, what you describe, this kind of industrial way of learning, where, you know, teachers teach and students learn, in historical terms, is a fairly recent phenomenon. You know, if you actually go way back, you know, all of our learning was through apprenticeship. We always learned from and with people. Now, learning was about coaching, mentoring. All animals learn in this way. Now, basically, they learn from and with each other in a very open environment with very good feedback mechanisms. This kind of mentoring, coaching, apprenticeship really was the root of learning in very ancient times. And then learning got industrialized fairly recently. You know, when it got instrumentalized in the long gone past, we didn't learn to be prepared for a specific job. We actually learned to become a better human. And actually, today you can go to the countries in East Asia. The Confucian approach to learning is also very much about this. You know, how can you become a more educated person, a better human? I think it is in the Western world that we instrumentalize education. We said, well, you want to get this job, so you need that kind of training. How can we mass produce that kind of knowledge and skills? And then, you know, when you ask that question, you arrive at the system that we have today, where you have a lot of students sitting in the classroom, you have only very few people, and you have those people broadcasting that kind of knowledge. But I think that approach is challenged today. You know, the kind of things that are easy to teach, easy to test, have also become easy to digitize, to automate. This modern world no longer rewards you just for what you know. Now, Google knows everything. The world rewards you for what you can do with what you know. So in a way, I think we need to go back to, you know, what makes humans flourish. How do we actually complement, not substitute, the artificial intelligence we create in our computers. And that's really what pedagogy is about. How do you create those learning environments that are about learning, not teaching? No. How do you support the people who do that? And I think that's a very, very different kind of mindset than just, designing a curriculum and then training teachers to deliver it and then delivering it and then hoping that students have learned it.
So one of the key things there that we're talking about is that our established systems and the hierarchical systems that you talked about there are they're really ingrained, and they support people who flourish within that particular mode of education to then reproduce that education as they become teachers because it worked for them. So what, in your view, is the key kind of lever that we can start to move, to start to shift the thinking and to start to reorganize the system to meet what you talked about there, the flourishing of humans rather than the mass production of automatons?
Well, I think a good start is ask the people who do that work every day. Teachers usually have a good sense of what it means to be a human, and they know what it means to motivate learners, what it means to create, engaging learning environments. And I think creating a bit more space for teachers to be creative designers of innovative learning environments rather than just, teach what's scripted somewhere, I think is a good starting point. If I think an education system would know what teachers do know, we would probably have a very different approach to education today. And this doesn't mean, idiosyncratic practice. This kind of professional autonomy doesn't mean, I do it my way, but I do things in the way that I recognize by my profession. That's again why it is so important to have not just individual teachers in a very atomistic way, but a very strong education profession where good practice is curated, where good practice is shared. And I think if we give a bit of more attention to this, I do think education is transforming, because those are the people who have that expertise, not as individuals, but as a profession. And if you look to the medical profession, how does medicine advances? Because doctors do clinical trials. They are not recipients of a Ministry of Health. There is no Ministry of Health that writes to you as a doctor how you should be working, but there is a very strong profession that develops its norms, its ethics, its approaches, and tests and retests them every day, and upgrades them and is, open to work with other fields. And I think if we had a bit more of that in the field of education, moving away from a vertical kind of approach to a more kind of lateral approach, I do think we would see a much more rapid evolution of practice. Because in a way you could say, some centuries ago, the systems that we have were actually quite effective. If the world changes very slowly, yes, you can have someone in government or in a university figuring out what students should be learning, and then train teachers how to teach that and then deliver it. That works in a static world. But think about the world in which we live today. You have climate change and technology, and every morning you wake up in a different world. So this kind of long process, these long hierarchical processes are breaking down. Now the structures that we have are not fit for these fast-moving times in which we live. The only way how you can address this is really to get people at the front line to become the architects and designers of the learning environments.
That's exciting to hear you talk about things like that, because I think superficially the understanding of the role of the OECD from on the floor, actually just with practitioners there, is around about that accountability and that performance, which I think is sometimes held in tension between that and the creativity and the innovation that you're talking about. Do you think that's a false dichotomy?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it is very important that we look at the outcomes. I think the cognitive, social, emotional outcomes that our education systems deliver should be present in all our minds every day. I mean, this is what education is about. But then, we should ask ourselves seriously and dispassionately, how do we support learners, educators, school systems best to deliver those kinds of outcomes. And I think this is where you need to rely on the people with the expertise. And I think we do far too little of this. If we would know what educators know, we would have very different school systems today. I think our systems are only a one-way road, right, when it comes to knowledge management. And I think absolutely, we need to have a very clear look at the results as an individual, as a teacher, as a school, as a system. But then, create those feedback mechanisms that help students learn better, help teachers teach better, help school systems to be more effective. And I think if you go back long enough in the past, learning and assessment were always integrated. If you made a mistake in an apprenticeship situation, someone will tell you. They say, look, it doesn't work like this. You need to improve this. So learning and assessment were always, two sides of the same coin. And then, we industrialized education. We divorced learning from assessment. We make you pile up years and years and years and years of learning. And then 10 years later, 12 years later, we call you back and say, tell me everything that you know in a very contrived, constrained, artificial setting. And we call that an exam. And that is creating a lot of the problems that we have today. That is creating this kind of vertical accountability pressures and doesn't help, learners learn better, teachers teach better. And I do believe today, through technology, we have a really great opportunity to reintegrate learning and assessment to basically ensure that the knowledge flows actually there that help us look at the outcomes, but then, learn from and with them as a profession, as a learner.
So you've articulated there a lot of the concerns that particularly my secondary colleagues have around about that exam accountability and the fact that although we're very lucky in Scotland with the Curriculum for Excellence, because we have permission to be interdisciplinary, to be creative, to use our professional judgment to create the curriculum with our learners. That works particularly well in primary schools, but then as you come up into secondary school with the kind of structures of time blocks of 50 minutes, and then that pressure towards the external examinations, then the learning becomes around about performance at those exams rather than that kind of deep exploration and that real, the human experience of learning. So what's the alternative instead of having those kind of national exams to be able to demonstrate that you've reached a particular level in your learning or a particular competence in one area or another?
I think the alternative is not to abandon the exam. The alternative is to make that, outward look at outcomes, a daily practice, not an end of school experience, but something that is very normal to us every day. Why do kids love computer games? What does a computer game do? It's actually a permanent assessment. It makes you actually realize where you can improve, where you're not too good. And actually, that's what we lack. And we put this pressure at the end point, often in a very shallow way. I mean, way the exams often test only a small slice of the experience that you have. And the consequence of this is that teaching becomes then about knowledge compression. Now, basically, you try to, rather than making you do an experiment, we just tell you the results of that experiment because that's the only thing you need to remember in the exam. And in a way, I think that's trickled down through the kind of school system. And I think the way to address this is really to make that kind of learning and exam a much more, connected experience with closed feedback loops. And then, at the end of the year, students will not be that phased about the exam because they used to look at the results of the work in a positive way.
That's really exciting, because I think what you talk about there is harnessing the power of the developments that we have right now, like AI, for example, because in our daily life, in my daily life, I'm never stuck without being able to refer somewhere else. So it's not about what I hold in my head, but it's how I can then judge various different sources critically, combine them, and then find a solution to whatever it is that I'm working on at that particular moment.
I think the I think the curriculum of excellence for excellence has a lot of strengths, but actually You know, the fact that teachers have discretion is only one ingredient of success. The other part, I do believe, is still missing, and that is the collaborative culture in this. You have a high degree of professional autonomy, but as an individual teacher, you cannot make up for the profession. You know, it's like, you know, you wouldn't ask a doctor to invent medicine. They are, you know, developed by the profession. You know, the kind of medicaments that you prescribe, they are, you know, owned by the profession. You use them as a doctor. And I think if we demand from individual teachers to reinvent those kinds of tools, they'll not necessarily succeed with this and not use their time efficiently. So I think what is lacking really is that collaborative culture that produces and stores and curates professional practice and wisdom. The system, you know, how does the system remember what's actually effective practice, good practice? And I think we do have far too few tools for this. If you do an amazing thing as a teacher in a school, in a classroom, very few people around you will notice, and very little of that will be, you know, accessible to future teachers. So I think that's what we, I think, need to address, even in a system like Scotland, in theory, provides that discretion. And only that will get you around, you know, the exam. It's the collective knowledge about good practice at the level of the student, at the level of the teacher, and ultimately at the level of the system.
So there, I mean, there are ways that people collaborate, and there's been, what's the word I'm looking for? Sorry. There have been trials in terms of things like the regional improvement collaboratives to get that collaboration moving across local authorities. I suppose as the experience of a teacher on the floor, there's so many time pressures that actually adding a layer of collaboration seems like another thing, that another draw on your time that you don't have. So where do we provide the space? How do we provide the space for that collaboration to happen?
Yeah, it's an interesting point. You know, actually, you know, you need to ask yourself, what's cause and effect here? You know, if you try to solve every problem by yourself, you're going to be extremely busy, extremely frustrated, and not necessarily very effective. I give you an example from my own country in Germany. You know, the model there was that as a teacher, you only have to be present in the school for the hours that you teach, and then you can go home and do whatever you like. So the result is that teachers teach in the morning, and then at home they have to figure out lots of problems, and they're all on their own with this. And in the end, they're all, you know, frustrated, and they feel huge pressures and huge levels of responsibility. You go to the neighboring country, Denmark, where teachers spend the whole day in the school, and many German teachers would say, I would never want to spend more time than I need to in the school. But there you have a wonderful environment. You have teachers who observe each other's classrooms, who engage in collaborative professional development. They assist each other on the grading of this. And actually you have a very different work environment. I think many of the work pressures that we create come from the organization of the work. And I add one more point to this. I think we spend a lot of energy and time on managing mistrust in the system. You know, most of the accountability structures that we have are not about making learning better. They're about actually, you know, mechanisms of control, administrative, you know, accountability and so on. And that's actually, you know, not necessarily helping people to become better. We looked at this once in the Thales survey. You know, many teachers complain that they're stressed, that they're overloaded. And then you ask yourself, actually, what are the drivers of that? Hours of instruction, time spent with students, actually had only a very modest relationship with perceived stress levels. So that's not where the problem comes from. General administrative work, you know, doing things that I don't perceive to be related to my work as a teacher, had a very steep relationship with time. So actually, it is, you know, the work organization that we create that creates that stress, not the actual work that is being done by teachers. And I think the more room you create for collaborative work among teachers, the lower, not the higher, the stress levels we are, the less, you know, teachers will be working and left on their own devices. So I don't think you're talking about adding things. It's about changing and replacing a current work organization with one that is framed around a different paradigm. Why am I so confident in saying this? Because look at the highest performing education systems. You know, look at an education system in Singapore or in Japan, where actually the work organization is all organized around professional collaboration. Teachers do lesson studies, teachers design the textbooks, teachers work, you know, on refining pedagogical practice. This is all done by the profession, but then they own that afterwards. You know, it helps them in their daily classroom practice. The same in the way we work with a student. You know, you have many teachers in Scotland who complain about deteriorating classroom discipline. Now, well, because many of those teachers do not know their students. They don't spend time with them outside the classroom setting. So they do not know their students. They do not know who they are. They do not know who they want to become. They do not know how to accompany them on their personal journey. And yes, then discipline will not be great because students will feel, you know, my teacher doesn't take an interest in me. Teachers' levels of support are low. And that's all what we see in the PISA data for Scotland. Now, whereas if you have a system like the Japanese where teachers, you know, even clean the classroom with as part of, you know, we are all in this together. This is our house. We are responsible for this. They cook their meals. You would say, oh my goodness, it's even more work for teachers. No, the opposite. This is the work that actually takes work away and creates that kind of environment where actually a positive disciplinary climate and teacher job satisfaction are created. We have measured it in our TALIS survey. The more time teachers spend on collaborative professional development, on classroom observation, on all those kinds of activities, the happier they were with their job and the greater their sense of self-efficacy.
Mm-hmm.
So again, you know, I don't think you should look at those things as additional responsibilities, but about responsibilities that change work practices.
The key phrase that stood out to me when you were talking there was the fact that it's that we spend a lot of time managing mistrust. And you described that between teachers and students, students and teachers, but also administrators and professionals. Some might say that the kind of accountability aspect is one of the drivers towards that framework in terms of we need to get that outcome. So we have to micromanage the process to get there. And so that time for collaboration where it exists can be contrived because it's about, you know, the system leader creating the framework for that collaboration. What's the key there? Or is it just about everybody just relaxing a little bit?
You know, I think I look at the accountability system more as a symptom than as a driver for the work. And I'll give you an example. You know, I think you might think that... you know, think about work organization. You know, you have country like, you know, China, Japan, where teachers do everything. You know, teachers teach. They are also the young mentors and coaches. They are the psychologists of students, the social workers. Now, if the student gets in trouble with the police are going to call the teacher to sort out things. You know, the teacher and students really are in this together. There are very few other types of professionals in the school, but the teachers have time for other things than teaching. They spend a lot of time on things other than teaching. You go to a system like Scotland or even more England, where people have said, well, you know, let's focus teachers on what they do best. You know, they should only spend time on teaching their own subject in their classroom, what they are specialist in. And then we hire a school psychologist, we hire a social worker, we hire whomever. And in the end, you have tailorized the work organization, you've disconnected responsibilities, you've disconnected fields of study, you've disconnected students from teachers. And that creates a demand for a huge kind of administrative structure behind it. You need to keep track of all those people. You need to keep track of all of those relationships. A lot of people are going to fall through the cracks. And that's then where the accountability and the kind of tracking of processes comes from. In a system where everybody knows everybody, where people take collective responsibility, where nobody falls through the cracks, you create that level of trust and collaboration that ultimately then doesn't create those symptoms. So again, you know, I don't think we should, you know, if you abandon the accountability system, you will not change anything. You'll probably do a lot worse because you won't even know the outcomes of your work. So I think the question is more how you can change the work organization in the system that then calls for a different kind of accountability system that is much more about professional accountability rather than administrative accountability. You know, again, you know, I cite, you know, countries like Singapore or Japan. Actually, if you regularly watch what other teachers do, if you engage in, you know, lesson study, research, collaborative research, this is actually pretty tough accountability regime. You see everybody, what everybody else is doing with what effect and so on. But it's a very different nature of accountability. It doesn't come top down. It doesn't come, you know, from the outside. It comes from the inside and it inspires and it changes practice. No? So that's really the question. You know, if you move from a kind of administrative work organization to a professional organization, you will also move from administrative accountability to this kind of professional accountability. No?
You've talked a lot about the different systems that you've seen as being successful. So is there a particular place that's really informed your thinking about pedagogy primarily? Is there a particular way of that you've seen in terms of practice, or is it much more about the whole picture?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've seen some amazing examples. I mean, but also how teachers really redesign, reimagine pedagogy. I give you an example. In Shanghai, in China, the teachers have a collaborative digital platform where you can, you know, upload your lesson plans, your projects, your pedagogical ideas and concepts. And the more other teachers will, you know, download your ideas, use them, improve them, criticize them, the more you will rise in recognition in the system. You know, at the end of the school year, your school principal will not only ask you how well did you teach the students in your class, but also what contribution did you make to pedagogy in the profession. Now, and if you have an idea for pedagogical innovation, well, it's actually very easy for you as a teacher to get a grant to try it out, you know, some money from the local administration. And if at the end of the school year, you've been reasonably successful, they will ask you, okay, can you help us, you know, try this out in 10 other schools with other people in other places? And then, you know, those pedagogies grow and they develop and they get, you know, a crowd curated, crowdsourced, and that really changes practice. You know how I came across this in a really funny way. We saw that, you know, Shanghai was the, you know, leading education systems in mathematics in 2012. And then we did a video study. We recorded, you know, lots of videos about mathematics teaching. We were very interested, you know, how this is work. And then we curated those videos, we coded them, we marked pedagogical practice. And about 9 months later, we sent those videos back to the, you know, teachers in Shanghai and said, you know, are these, you know, correctly done? Is it all appropriate? And they wrote back to us and said, that was 9 months later. Yeah, you know, this is all correct what you did, but, you know, why did you choose so old-fashioned pedagogies in Shanghai? In a course of 9 months, the whole profession had changed, you know, places, had really moved on. And what they did 9 months before was really outdated for them. And that is something that we do not have in our parts of the world where you, you know, get what you get from teacher education and use it for your whole life. There is no drive in the profession actually to reinvent itself through those kinds of mechanisms. So that's just, you know, one example that really struck me where you can see really when teachers use their knowledge collectively, you can really do amazing things now.
The measures of success, though, can cause an issue there because the things that are easily measurable aren't necessarily the things that are the most valuable in terms of practice and outcomes for young people.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, that just calls on us to develop better ways of observation. You know, I think actually we are usually not very creative when it comes to measurement. We often associate, you know, measurement with, you know, just some test. Mm-hmm. But I do believe, you know, it's going to be very hard to improve what you cannot see in some ways. So I think making things measurable is very important. But there we have to become more creative and actually teachers themselves. You need to become better at observing, you know, the efficacy of their own practices. And, you know, I think that's really, really important.
That speaks to me because my passion is early years. So observation and responding and picking up on various different ways of measuring success is bread and butter.
Absolutely. And you know, we a couple of years ago, we were, you know, confronted with this, you know, can we actually measure early learning outcomes? You know, and then someone said to me, well, you know, show me that you can measure empathy for a five-year-old child. And then, you know, we talk about measurement, because believing you, you could never do that. And actually, we developed a really, really good measure of empathy. It was not particularly difficult. If you start to think about it, you give children, you know, a book with different characters, you observe their reactions. And actually, you know, you can observe very, very complex human traits in quite reliable ways. But usually we don't think about it. We just have a very kind of stereotype way of measurement. And I think particularly in the early years, you know, if you as an educator cannot observe, you know, traits that we value, curiosity, empathy, you know, social behavior, pro-social behavior and all of that, it's going to be very, very hard to design learning environments in which you develop those intentionally. And I think in a way you can say, well, teaching students in high school is a lot easier than teaching children in the early years, because high school students, they talk to you, they can express themselves, and they can, you know, it's much easier to measure what they do. In the early years, all of these things are really, really hard, but I think we have to do a lot better there now.
So I think there's skills that early years practitioners and teachers have in terms of understanding and being able to demonstrate progress over time through those observations that then get lost and are not necessarily valued further up the system. And so it's great to hear that that's one of the ways that we could start to move things forwards.
Yeah, no, absolutely agree. I think that's a really important point, that actually, you know, we often push primary schooling down into the early years rather than thinking about, you know, how can school learn from what we do particularly well. I would argue, you know, many of the knowledge, skills, attitudes, and values that are most important in the 21st century are learned best in the early years. You know, in a way, you could say school was the institution of the 20th century. No? Early years is the institution of the 21st century, because, you know, the future is about curiosity, is about empathy, is about, you know, complex problem solving, is about, you know, living with children and with other people who are different from you. And we do that best in the early years. And then later on, you know, we try to make people, you know, we did an assessment of social emotional skills, and we found that across the board, everywhere where we looked at this, 15-year-olds were less creative than 10-year-olds. Mm-hmm. If I would tell you, well, your 15-year-olds do worse in mathematics than your 10-year-olds, you would say, well, that's crazy. It's not possible. We always learn something. But actually, our education systems destroy some of the capabilities that are innate to us as humans. This kind of compliance-based, conformity-driven culture in education drives out some of the creativity that actually in early childhood education we develop very naturally. So I do think, you know, I think there's a lot of learning that could happen in the school years.
Some of the most effective practice in the early years is about knowing when not to intervene and knowing when to step back and observe, and potentially, like you say, in terms of the enabling environments, put a provocation there or suggest something. That I think sometimes gets misinterpreted as you're not educating there, because you're not planning lesson, making sure they're going through certain steps of learning. So there's a big shift in terms of the role of the adult to be able to meet the kinds of ways of education that you're talking about.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure. I actually do think there is a global trend towards more project-based learning, where students have to learn to set their own learning goals, where students have to become good at monitoring their own learning progress and so on. Because I think what we all know is that in the world of today, you know, it's not what you do in school, it's how your motivation, your capacity to continue learning throughout life on your own, to organize yourself, to have that, you know, resilience, is increasingly important. So actually, I do think there are some very good examples now where also in school, as a teacher, you become less of an instructor and more of a coach, a mentor, a facilitator, an evaluator, a designer of the environment in which students can then learn on their own. So I think, yeah, there are some really interesting efforts. When we talked about exam, if I would do an exam today, one thing I would certainly look at is, can students develop their own ideas and projects? If you can't do that, you'll be in trouble in this world.
Mm-hmm. So from all of our discussions there, what's the key message that you would give to teachers and practitioners to inform their own pedagogical practices?
Yeah, learn from and with each other, become good at, observing effective practice elsewhere, become good at codifying it, avoid, reinventing the wheel every day, avoid to be idiosyncratic, work together to frame, good practice. And again, I don't think it's adding work, it's making your job a lot easier, a lot more interesting, and a lot more inspiring.
What's next for you in terms of your work with the OECD and your own professional journey?
Oh, actually, we do work a lot on the fields that we talked about, the measurement of social emotional outcomes. Can we make those outcomes better visible? Can we make them tangible? That's a really, really important question. Can we become better at measuring the things that matter rather than the things that can be easily observed? So I think a lot of effort is going into this. Connecting policy and practice. Now, I think some really, really interesting work happening at the OECD around those lines currently. Now, strengthening, a more outward-looking culture. And obviously, we work at the international, at the global level, now, to how do you get actually education systems move away from this very domestic, inward-looking perspective towards looking outwards to the next teacher, the next school, the next country. So I think really exciting work at the OECD.
Thank you so much for your time this afternoon. It's been a real pleasure to speak with you.
Absolutely. Great pleasure. And look forward to see the result.
Thank you.
I found that conversation with Andreas really interesting, and I keep going back and wishing that I'd taken the conversation through different paths. I do think that I should have asked more about PISA and the overall impact of the OECD. And I'm not sure, what I would have liked to dig down deeper into is to whether the perceived negative impacts of the PISA system is something that we kind of do to ourselves, or whether it's inherent in the design of PISA itself. And I'm not really sure which side of that I land on at the moment. What do you think? He also makes a few assumptions about Scottish education and the things that we need to have in place to improve. And I wonder whether his assumptions match what the lived experiences of educators on the floor. Does it match your experience? Again, it's a really thought-provoking one for me, and I would love to be able to go back and relive that conversation. So Andreas, if you're listening, I would really love to revisit some of our conversation if you'd be open to that. Thanks very much for listening, and do share your thoughts using the hashtag ESPedagogyPodcast. Thanks very much for listening. Bye.